Today, we're going to finish with Tevye and his family. We get through with that. And on Thursday, we finish up with Shalom Aleichem. So we'll be done with one writer altogether. Six of those stories, as I'll repeat over and over, are Tevye and his family. Two other stories are just two stories written by Shalom Aleichem. He wrote 26 volumes of short stories, plays, and novels. So he was a hugely prolific writer, and you're going to read two stories that have nothing to do with Tevye. The exam, because of the fact that you got pinched by this lousy weather, I put the midterm up online already. So when you go, if you go to trunk, you'll see that the exam that was there as an example from a year or 2 years ago is gone, and the new one that's up there now says February 26th, 2015. That's the exam that you're going to take. You're going to get it theoretically on Thursday, but you got it already today. You're going to hand it in on March the 6th. Now, you'll get all these instructions. I'll go over this over and over. It's also written down. March the 6th, you're going to hand it in. Then you got one more week before vacation. And then when you come back from vacation, on the second day of class, you're going to get your exam back. So it takes us about two weeks to read all of them. And they each get read twice, but we'll go over all of it. If you get print out a copy of the exam, bring it with you on Thursday, and we will go over the whole exam with you. It'll be stress-free, as much as you can be stress-free. Try not to be too neurotic about grades. It's easy for me to say. I haven't taken a test in a long time, but that's okay. And then we can't stop. We have no break from the readings. We're through with Shalom Aleichem. You will immediately begin reading new writers. Other writers, and very just different, and it'll be an opportunity for you to maybe keep some notes and to write down plots, because on the first exam, you get 8 stories. On the second exam, it's 20 stories. That's the second exam that you get the last day of class, and you get another 10 days to do that one, except for seniors, they have to get it a little bit faster. So, new readings. While you're taking this exam, you're going to be continue to read other short stories, new settings, new stuff. So it's going to be a little bit stressful for you for a week. Keep reading the emails that have plot content, particularly, so that you can keep up, ask questions if you need to know. If you take a look at your syllabus also, we're on time. We didn't get behind. I talked a little faster. We got up, and we're okay. So if you look at the syllabus, and you see what the titles on the syllabus are, really for each lecture, for each discussion that we have, you know, the end of the patriarch, the new Torah, Karl Marx, the emergence, particularly today, of when we get through with modern children, then we move into Hodel and Chava. What do they share? What do Hodel and Chava share? Why are they different, even from Zeitl and Belka? They bond. These two daughters bond. What did they bond over? Hodel and Chava share what? What do Hodel and Chava share? One's husband is named Feferel. The other husband's name is Fietke Galagan. One of them isn't Jewish. One is Jewish, the other is not, but both of them are ideologically what? They're both Marxists. These two girls fell in love. I mean, they fell in love with a new ideology. They fell in love with the new Torah, and that's what you're going to be dealing with, and that's what Tevye has to deal with. With the first daughter, Modern Children, Zeitl, we also learn what's the most important thing for you to understand in the course of these readings, of these first 6 stories anyway. The nature of Tevye, who he is, what his family is all about, how he is different also, because Shalom Aleichem has created a typical father, and yet there's something different about him. He's typical in that he's the patriarch. He does everything that a patriarch is supposed to do. He understands his traditions. He expects nothing back from his daughters and his children. He knows that he was a shlemazel. He knows that God blesses him. He's a man of deep faith. All of that we know. But Shalom Aleichem has also done something else with him. For instance, in the story Modern Children, when she says, I don't want to marry this guy, this old man, and she throws herself on him and weeps, what should a traditional shtetl father do? either bang her, beat her, get a stick, beat the hell out of her, throw away and say, you'll do it. Stick his finger in her face and say, you will do what I tell you to do. That was that's what Shlomo Aleichem understood and knew. But he was also a writer and wanted to create another kind of character. So what did he do? What kind of father did he create? A bully? A brigand? A child abuser? No. On the bottom of page 54 of Modern Children, you've been through this, but I'll read it again. She throws herself on his shoulders, and he says, if you say no, it's no, he says to her. Can you? That's not a line that any father would say in the shtetl. If you say no, it's no. What's the line? If I say yes, it's yes. That's the way the shtetl father would answer. If you say no, it's no. Nobody's going to force you. It's exactly the way the shtetl does not act. We meant it for the best. We did it for your own sake. But if it doesn't appeal to you, what are you going to do? Apparently, it was not ordained by God. Oh, thank you, Father, thank you, Zeitel, Setha. She cries and falls on my neck again and dissolves in tears. Look, I said, you've cried enough for one day. Even eating pastry becomes tiresome. Little joke. Climb into the wagon, let's go home. Lord knows what your mother will be thinking. So we both got into the cart, and I tried to calm her down. I tell her that we meant any harm to her. God knows the truth. All we wanted was to shield our daughter from poverty. God knows that. Then he's got one thing that he can use. He's not going to hit her. He's not going to abuse her. He's got one more tool in his arsenal. So it was not meant, I said, that you should have riches, all the comforts of life, or that we should have a little joy in our old age. After all our hard work, harnessed, you might say, day and night to a wheelbarrow, no happiness, only poverty and misery and bad luck over and over. Oh, Father! She cries, bursting into tears again. I'll hire myself out as a servant. I'll carry rocks. I'll dig ditches. But just don't make me marry him. Lazy Wolf, the old man. So what does he dig up? What has he got? What's in his DNA? What's in Tevye's DNA? It's probably in everybody's DNA there. Guilt, the big G. How many of you, has any of you ever been exposed to the big G? When your parents don't know what to do with you, all they can do is what? Make you feel the big R, rotten, and guilty for doing whatever it is, for causing them misery. It's in the DNA. They can't help themselves. It's in the shtetl. They had no other weapons other than physical force, so they used guilt whenever it was. I remember very vividly, my mother was European born. I'm first generation American, and my mother would take a look at my brother. My mother couldn't read or write, but she would get my report card and look at it. I wanted to please my mother more than anything in the world. So I give my mother my report card. She looked at it, and she said, your brother's doing better. My brother wasn't even going to school, but as far as she knew she could utz me, she could get me, she could do whatever it is. They had it. She didn't know anything about what she was doing except it was in her nature. Same thing when I came home late, 3 o'clock in the morning, I would get home and I could see the Venetian blind was cracked. Either she left it cracked deliberately or she had it attached to a string. I couldn't tell. But as soon as I got close to the house, the Venetian blind closed, which made me, what was I supposed to know? She would stay up all night until I got home. I was a wreck by the time I got home. My mother staying up 3 o'clock in the morning. Anyway, Tevye was able to do this. He tried it. He gave it all he had. And that, in a sense, is what he was. But it wasn't going to work on this kid, so she was deliberately going to go and marry the one she wants, and the story ends that way. They have a nice little wedding. What else does it tell us also about the nature of the shtetl marriage? What do you learn about the shtetl marriage, the traditional marriage, not the one between Zeitel and Muttel, but the one between Tevye and Golda? What's the nature of that marriage? What's the nature of the marriage? How does Tevye deal with gold? What's Tevye's? In a many way, it's also Sholem Aleichem. Sholem Aleichem creates Tevye as an interesting character. He creates Golda as a stereotype. Golda is not an interesting character. Golda is the woman, the mother, the wife in the shtetl that everybody expects her to be without any variation. And what then becomes the relationship? Well, what is she? How does Tevye deal with her? What's the relationship between the two of them? Some of you are going to be married someday. You'll have a relationship. What's this relationship like? What was the shtetl marriage like? 100% of the time, how were the marriages made? They were all arranged. So they met each other through an arranged marriage when they were kids. Tevye might have been 14, 13, 15, whatever. She was 12, 13, 14, married to a loser, him. Then all of a sudden he got wealthy, but she never lost that little extra touch of bitterness. But what about her? What was she as a woman? As a shtetl mother and wife that results in how Tevye treats her. I mean, after all, modern children, what's the basis of Tevye's deciding how he's going to inform Golda that she's not going to have as a son-in-law the richest man in the town, who is Lazer Wolf, would have been a terrific marriage. Lazer Wolf would have provided them with enormous yichus. He was the town nugget. He was the rich man, and Tevye would have been then the father-in-law, even though the guy's the same age, of the richest man in the shtetl. That's not going to happen. Why? Because Tevye capitulated. Tevye gave in to his daughter. So it's not going to happen, this wedding. Can he sit there and tell Golda, Golda, it's not going to happen. She's going to marry Motel Kamzoil, who's a tailor with a thread and a needle, a young Jewish kid who's got nothing, and I approved of this marriage. Now, if he said that, what would she and the community feel? What would the community and Golda say of Tevye's stature in the community? It would sink like a rock. You allowed your daughter to turn down a marriage with Lazer Wolf to marry this poor, miserable, wretched kid? So Tevye, who is very much aware of his status in the community, won't allow that to happen. So what does he want to do? What does he do? What does he do? It's the key. If you don't get it, you haven't read the story. What does he do with Golda and those that would believe what he's about to do? He makes up one fantastic lie. He makes up a lie. He also knows what's going to ring her bell in this lie. He knows how to deal with it because he knows that this is a woman consumed by what? What are the things that drive Golda? Say it again? Family, well, family, yeah, but what's going to get her to respond to what he's about to do? Superstition? Dreams? Dreams. She is really into dreams. So Tevye sits there and says, what am I going to do? How am I going to tell her? How am I going to convince the community that this is what? This is made in heaven, ordained, and God's will. I have nothing to do with this. So Tevye is figuring out a way not to get involved and not to do anything. And he does. He makes up this fantastic story, happens to be a pretty good actor himself, and he lies. If you haven't read the story, read it and understand how he gets through this enormous lie and allows these kids to go on. And the story ends on they live happily ever after. He's poor, the kid is poor, wretched, and that's the way it is. Okay? But if you haven't read the story and you start telling me that Tevye did this or did that without reading it, you're going to be in big trouble. So make sure you understand the nature of Tevye. So what kind of marriage is this? What kind of marriage is this? It's a marriage based on lie. It's a marriage based on lies. It's also a marriage based on the fundamental ignorance, not stupidity, but ignorance of the shtetl woman. She knows nothing except what little bit of the Kabbalah she might have gathered. And so she starts hearing about dreams and spooks and ghosts and goblins and coming, and she believes it all. her hair stands on end, and you can get her to believe it. So read carefully how Tevye manages this and manages with a really ignorant community. Now, that's one set of glasses. The other set of lenses is also some people in the community would very easily understand exactly what Tevye is doing, because the community is going along. They're moving, they're maturing, they're understanding what the world is out there. They don't all, but some, the readers of this story would say, he's making a fool out of his wife. And how does Tevye deal with Golda in any case? He never tells her the truth. He never tells her the truth. It's one constant lie after another. That, you know, Sholem Aleichem is digging this out. And indeed, that's the way they simply did with it. Okay. But the story ends on a light side. Let's get to the darkness, to Hodel. And Hodel is a story that is dark. Okay? Again, the tragedy has already taken place. In a sense, it's a tragedy. In a sense, yeah, please. Medrash. A medrash is a tale. What is a medrash? A good question, because I didn't gloss it. A medrash is a homily, a story, like a fable, an Aesop fable that has at the end of it a morality, a little point I want to make. So he's going to tell a little story that's going to make a point. She says, enough of your stories already. Shut up, let's get going. So Golda has heard enough of his storytelling already. Tevye tries to understand what happened with Hodel. What doesn't he understand? What do you think were the key things for those of you that read it so far? What are the issues with Tevye at the beginning of the story as he's telling Mr. Sholem Aleichem, I don't understand what happened? In fact, that line repeats itself over and over. I don't understand. And as children, Hodel gets to say, Father, you'll never understand. What is it that he hasn't gotten? He hasn't gotten Marxism. He's never heard of Marxism. He doesn't know it. He hasn't heard of it. He doesn't understand it. And he makes mistakes. He does things that even the audience understands. For instance, Hodel. He loves her very much. And he says, you know, he says on page 64 of our text, that he knows his daughter is beautiful. This Hodel is beautiful. How can I describe her to you? Like Esther in the Bible. And as if that weren't bad enough, she had to have brains. She can write and she can read. Unusual in the shtetl. Yiddish and Russian both. So Hodel reads Russian and Yiddish, and books she swallows like dumplings. You may be wondering how a daughter of Tevye happens to be reading books with her, when her father deals in butter and cheese. And how does he answer that question? How does he answer that question? You may be wondering, how come my daughter can read? Is he going to say, because her father is so smart? No, he says, that's what I like to know myself. How did she learn? Who taught her? Not me, because he knows what the role of the girl is in the shtetl, next to nothing. So how did she learn it? Well, how did she learn it? How did she learn to read and write Russian? Where did she learn all of this stuff from? No, the priest is the next story. A very good observation, because by your mistake, you learned something. The next story is Chava. That's where the priest comes in. This one's got no priest. This one's just got a nice little Jewish boy who happens to be a goddamn Marxist. And does Tevye know it when he picks the kid up on the street? No. Tevye has no idea what he's doing. He has no idea when he picks this kid up on page 65, he sees this little boy, this little kid, well, you know, college age maybe, but who the hell, nobody in the shtetl's going to college, right? He picks this kid up and he starts a conversation because Tevye likes to talk on page 65. So they're chatting, right? And he says, who are you? What are you doing here? I'm getting ready for my examinations. What are you doing examinations? What case is I'm going to college? So the kid is out of town. He's running around. And he starts up, who are you? Who's fun? And he tells him who he finally is on page 66. He says, my father is Patrick. What does Patrick do? His father. His father does what? I mean, we're looking at people who have very, very, very menial jobs. Tevye has got big one. He's got cigarettes. That's the other one. He's got butter and cream. This guy rolls cigarettes. He's a cigarette maker. So he rolls cigarettes. What he uses for flat tobacco, you know what he's probably using? Don't even ask. what he's using for tobacco or what he's even using for paper. But he's rolling cigarettes and people are desperate to buy it, so they'll buy whatever they get from him, okay? And Tevye says, and you go to the university? Yes, the university. He says, what do you eat? He says, I can eat anything I can get. So the kid is starving. He's not eating. He's coming home now, right? Tevye Kennedy says, I understand. He says, you're not particular. Is there something to eat? You eat. If not, you bite your lip and go to bed hungry. But is it worthwhile as long as you can attend the university? You're comparing yourself to the rich people of Yehupetz. At these words, Patrick bursts out. Don't you dare compare me to them. They can go to hell as far as I'm concerned. So what is it that Tevye doesn't get? The readership, the readers, no. Uh-oh, what do we got here? We got a revolutionary kid. We got some kid who doesn't like rich people, okay? You seem to be somewhat prejudiced against the rich, I said. Did they divide your father's inheritance among themselves? A joke, right? Because your father's got what? Nothing. So yeah, did they divide with me? Let me tell you, he says, it may well be that you and I and all the rest of us have no small share in their inheritance, because the days, he's saying, of inequality are over, and I'm going to lead the revolution. Tevye doesn't know what the hell he's talking about, right? Right? He says, listen to me, right? He says, but I love the way you talk. So what does Tevye do? He hires, but he says, come on home with me. The reader sees this. What is the reader yelling? Oedipus! Don't do it. Or are you looking for trouble? Don't bring this kid home. If you do, you got nothing but good-looking daughters. You're bringing this kid home whose ideas you don't understand, and so they go home. And Tevye likes, Tevye brings the kid in. And then on the 67, and from that evening on, our young friend began coming to our house almost every day to do what? To tutor, right? Tevye doesn't get it. On the bottom of 67, he had the wildest notions, the most peculiar ideas. Everything was upside down, topsy-turvy. For instance, according to his way of thinking, a poor man was far more important than a rich one. And if he happened to be a worker, too, then he was really the brightest jewel in the diadem. He who toiled with his hands looked first in his estimate. So it's all clear, easy, simple Marxism. The workers of the world, all of that stuff. And Tevye just doesn't get it. He doesn't understand it, all right? He never gets it, okay? And then in the middle of page 68, he says, Tevye, Reb Tevye, you have very fine daughters. Now, how does Tevye react to that one? He says, is that so, said I. Thanks for telling me. After all, they have someone to take after. I'm their father, after all. So Tevye is filled with himself. Tevye is also a snob and believes in what? He believes in the order of the shtetl. And what is the order of the shtetl? You're born, and unless you get mazel, you're born miserable and wretched, and unless you get lucky and God wills it, you die miserable and wretched. And above all, how does he feel about getting out of your class? You don't move out of your class. What are you, a cigarette maker's son going? I mean, what after all is one of the bases of this country? The idea that there is supposedly social mobility. We probably got more than most every other country in the world, and yet we don't like it. We aggravate about it. But in the shtetl, there was zero social mobility. Tevye is a miracle that he made it from where he was to where he finally got, okay? So now this kid is saying you got very fine daughters. The oldest one, says Pfeffel, the oldest one especially is a very bright girl. She's all there. I know without you telling me, said I. The apple never falls far from the tree. And I glow with pride. Glow with pride. But the audience, the readers are saying, boy, get ready, kid. Are you asking yourself for trouble? All right. Then, by the way, just getting ready, he meets the matchmaker again. This other sort of a mirror image of Tevye as a schlemazel. Tevye had seven daughters. What about the matchmaker? He's got, as soon as the matchmaker tells the readers that, he says, you got seven daughters? The matchmaker says, I got seven daughters. Together, they got 14 daughters. That's two losers. In the shtetl, that's two losers. And who knows it? The people who are reading this stuff. that there's nothing going to come good out of the friendship between two guys with 14 daughters, okay? So this is it. And then the matchmaker is trying to desperately to make a living. How does he make a living? How does that, you know, now the matchmakers online look really gorgeous and they got these terrific electronic matchmaking things. The matchmaker in the shtetl was another loser desperately trying to make a match and then get a little commission. You make a little commission, but this guy can't do anything right, all right? He says, I got this one guy. I think I got your daughter is perfect. He wants a pretty girl. What kind of guy wants just a pretty girl? Right? You know, so he says, I got one for you. And Tevye, then Tevye has a fantasy. I'm finally going to get what I wish for. And what is it Tevye wishes for? What did he always want for his daughters? Security. And he wanted to be the father-in-law of a rich man. A father-in-law and a rich man. When Tevye finally gets what he wants, it's terrible. But he wishes that. When his wish comes true, it's awful. But that's what he wanted. So then he sees it's happy, it's wonderful, and he's all set. Hodel's going to have a boyfriend. And on the bottom of 448, it happens that he sees the two of them coming out of the woods together, holding hands. And he knows something is wrong, right? At first, as they come out of the woods on the top of 71, at this the couple stops, not knowing what to do or say. So they're hesitant. They stand there awkward and blushing with their eyes lowered. The eyes are very important in all of these stories. But now Hodel and Pfeffel, which is his Yiddish name, little pepper pot, have their eyes lowered. What is the significance of the lowered eyes? What do you think? David? There's more to it than that, because there's great significance to two things. You lower your eyes, which you always do in front of your father. And what do you never do? If lowering your eyes is respect, remember, Mottl never looked Tevye in the eye, and here they come out of the woods and their heads are lowered. You never look your father in the eye. You never stare at him, you never look. You always have your head bowed in respect. So their eyes are lowered. They come out, okay, and then it bangs at them. It's on 71, a couple of lines down. Father, you can congratulate us. Congratulate you? I said, what happened? Did you find a treasure buried in the woods, or were you just saved from being some terrible danger? Congratulate us, says Pfeffel this time. We're engaged. Tevye normally, the father in the shtetl would do what? Stay right there. I just want to get a twig or two, and I'll come right back and beat the living crap out of you, then drag you off to the rabbi who will lock you up in the local Jewish jail, and you won't eat for about a month. That's what happens when boys and girls do what you're about to do, okay? We're engaged. What do you mean engaged? That's as far as he goes. Don't you know what engaged means, says Pfeffel, looking me straight in the eye? Shlomo Malachim doesn't throw that in gratuitously, looking me straight in the eye. It means that I'm going to marry her, and she's going to marry me. Well, the world, this is the world falling apart. I look him back in the eye and say, when was the contract signed? And why didn't you invite me to the ceremony? All right, but it's over. It's too late. Tevye has lost his authority with his family, okay? He says, we have to get married fast. Not because she's pregnant, God forbid. No, it's what? He says, I got to go away. Now, where is he going? I have to leave. We have to get married because I have to leave. And he says, where are you going? And he says, a line that you never dream of hearing in the shtetl, I can't tell you. I can't tell you where I'm going, all right? I'm about to go away, he says on the bottom, and top of 72. That I can't tell you, he says. It's a secret. So what are these kids that Tevye knows nothing about? What are they? It's the 1890s. It's the 1890s. What's going on? Dostoevsky was almost shot for causing revolution. What's in the air in Tsarist Russia? It's not only in Tsarist Russia, it's all over Europe. But in Europe, it hasn't gotten violent. The only place it got violent was the Commune of 1870 in Paris. So the Paris Commune was a manifestation of socialism, Marxism, communism, whatever. So that the socialism was in the air. There were revolutions that were stewing all over Europe, and here And so the kids themselves are reflections of it. Marx has already written Das Kapital. He's already been exiled. He's already been, I mean, so it's a spirit that's all over Europe. That sense of socialism is beginning to be dominant all over, but he can't tell. So these kids are going off to do what? There was a failed revolution in Russia in 1905. Then came the successful. When was the successful revolution in Russia? 1917. These kids are precursors of the 1917 revolution. These are the kids who turned into Bolsheviks. These are the kids who turned out to be the ones who stayed in Russia and brought the Tsar to his knees and then finally to his death, okay? The kids know their father. The kids know them. He says, I can't tell you. So in the middle of 72, come, father, kiss me. And they both grab hold of me, she on one side, he on the other. They begin to kiss and embrace me, I to kiss them in return. And in this great excitement, they begin to kiss each other. It was like going to a play. He said, well, so everybody's kissing each other, which means Tevye's goose is already cooked. It's over. Tevye has lost it. Okay. He says, what does he think about? What's the only thing that Tevye and Gold ever think about? What about the dowry? You need clothes. We got to go to Bergdorf's. We got to go to Bloomingdale's. We got to get all your stuff. They say, no, we got to go to Kohl's. We got to go to Ocean State Job Lot. Wherever they're going, no, we don't need anything. We are now, we don't need anything, okay? And there was a quiet little wedding. To make a long story short, they got married. Fills Golder with what? The story of an inheritance. There's money. The kid's going away. So what does he do again? To Golder. The big L. He lies. He lies to Golder, and Golder gets away. On the top of 73, I invented a story about a rich aunt in Yehupetz and inheritance, all sorts of foolishness. So he lies to her. But what Sholem Aleichem never does do is develop Golda as a character. She's one-dimensional, maybe two-dimensional, but she's not interesting. She's just a stereotype. So Sholem Aleichem creates with one character someone who's interesting with Tevye, but with Golda he doesn't do anything. That you can invent, this woman just acts like a complete boob. I invented a story. So she never pursues it, she never pushes on it a little bit. So the wedding is over. And off he goes. He goes to the station. Tevye takes him to the station. He runs away. Off he goes. Tevye doesn't understand any of it. On the bottom of 73, she says, what is she talking about? I thought I was getting even with her for the pain she and her new husband of hers had caused me. But did she care? Not at all. She pretended not to understand what I was saying. I talked to her about Pfeffel. She answered me with the cause of humanity and workers and other such talk. Never does Tevye get it. What does she mean by workers? What's Tevye's goal in life? What does he want? He wants to be a rich man. I don't care about the workers. I care about me, my family, and that's it. Is Tevye a revolutionary? No. Is Sholem Aleichem, one of you asked me, is Sholem Aleichem a revolutionary? I don't know. I don't think so, because if he were a revolutionary, maybe the cause of these kids would have been successful, because it isn't. He just says, these are the forces that are now unleashed in the shtetl, and this is what's happening. What good is your humanity and your work, as I say, if it all a secret? Where did he go and why? What's going on? Where is he going? And off he goes, and that's it. And then 2-3 weeks go by, months go by, they don't hear from him. What is the kid expecting? What are they both expecting? That these two kids, along with their friends, are about to start the revolution. What happens? Where do they wind up? Where do they wind up? In jail. It doesn't work. So it's not no great idealized, glorified story. Okay, so Tevye sees her. He doesn't ask her any questions. On the bottom of 74, top of 75, where is he, your predestined one? And she's going around moping now. He is far away. What is he doing there? Turn over to 75. He's serving time. Serving time? Yes. What did he do? She doesn't answer me. She looks me straight in the eyes and doesn't say a word. Why? What's going through her head? What am I going to talk to him about? You know, when you see the alienation between parents, how many of you have felt that alienation? How many of you expressed that alienation? How many of you are able to communicate with your parents? How many of you are not able to communicate with your parents? Here we got that world is now falling apart, all right? He doesn't even know what serving time means. What is it? What is this all going on? And indeed, that's it. The Jewish holidays come, and Tevye is watching her, and then she comes up to him again in the middle of the holidays and says on the top of 76, I have something to tell you, Father. I have to say goodbye to you, and I think it's for always. Now, who does he not tell? Who is she talking to all the time? She's talking to her father. She's not talking to her mother. She's not talking to Golda. She tells her father, I have to go, and I think it's for always. You know, this is not what you hear in the shtetl. I'm leaving, and I'm never coming back? I spoke so softly that I could barely hear her. She looked at me in a way that I shall never forget. She's going away, and that's it. The authority of the shtetl father is gone. It's gone because Tevye has let it go, and that's what's going to happen. She's going to go. Where is he? He's over there. What happened now? He was arrested, tried, jailed, and now what? What happened to Russians like this in the last years of the Tsar? You were sent to Siberia, the Siberian exile, what we call now the gulags after the Cold War, but they just sent him, so he's gone far away, and what's she gonna do? What is the choice? Either I am my children, my father's children, my parents' children, or I am my husband's children. Some of you are gonna marry people that your parents may or may not approve of. You'll have to figure out that one. And here we got the changing of the guard. No longer do I marry who my parents pick. I now marry for love. And we'll watch the shtetl disintegrate on the basis of who it is that you're going to marry. Okay? Tevye tries to hold on to his values, he says on top of 77. I want to ask you only one thing. Did you ever hear of a girl marrying a man so that she could follow him to the ends of the earth? And she answered, with him I'll go anywhere. I pointed out how foolish this was. And she said, Father, you will never understand. So I told her a little tale. She says, you know, what am I going to talk to you about? You don't get it. They're now living in two different worlds. And Tevye doesn't quite understand it. On the bottom of 77, he goes, listen to me, Golda. You light the samovar and make some tea while I go get the horse and wagon ready. I'm taking Huddle to the station in the morning. Again, Golda doesn't know anything. What's her job? What is the stereotype? The stereotype is the Jewish mother who cooks. That's all she does. She makes the food and that's it. And curses every once in a while. And once I make up the story about how she had to go to Yehupetz, I'm from there farther on because of the same old inheritance. So the story is made up and he lies to her. This is it. He takes her to the train on the bottom of page 78. I finished talking. She falls on my neck and begins to weep. Goodbye, Father, she cries. Goodbye. God alone knows when we shall see each other again. It's interesting. She probably uses the phrase God alone because what is it likely that she and Pfeffel are? I mean, are they go to synagogue on Friday night and Saturday? What are these two people? They take marks and they take marks for better or worse. And what about marks in religion? None. Religion is the opiate of the people. Religion is what causes all this misery among human beings. So she says, may God only knows. That sort of comes out of her mouth, and that's it. That's too much for Tevye. Well, that was too much for me. I remember that Hodel when she was still a baby. I carried her in my arms. I carried her in my arms. So he says, I carried her in my arms. I carried her in my arms. And then dot, 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 dot. So what does he do? That's not supposed to happen. He cries. He weeps. Tevye, after all, keeps saying, I'm a man. I don't cry. I'm the patriarch. I don't cry. I'm the father. I don't cry. Forgive me, Mr. Shalom Aleichem, for acting like an old woman. If you only knew what a daughter she is, if you could only read the letters she writes, what a daughter. So he picks her up and puts her on a pedestal because she writes such wonderful letters. And then he ends, Shalom Aleichem lets us end with a little bit of a joke. And now let's talk about more cheerful things. Tell me, what do you hear about the cholera in Odessa? Let's talk about the plague. And the story ends, okay? So The first one, now comes the real trouble. It's Marxism is out there, and there's nothing that can be stopped, and it's going to happen. This is now Tevye's value, and Tevye's values can't change. He can let this daughter go away. Why? He made up a story. He made up a story, and what's the bottom line? He's a Jew. The bottom line is she didn't do the ultimate. If you remember one of the slides, when the pain is great, the disgrace is greater. This is the story where that line repeats itself 3, 4, 5 times. The pain is great, but the disgrace of what? My daughter married a goy. That's as low as it gets. Now, Shalom Aleichem is not making value judgment. If you try to figure out where Shalom Aleichem is coming from, it's not that simple. You know, whose eyes are his? You got two Gentiles in the story. Who are they? Who are the two Gentiles in the story? Very easy to make them look lousy, to stereotype them. Who are they? One is the boy himself, Fietke Galagan. We never meet him, but he's going to be a second Gorky. What does Tevye say? Do any of you know who Maxim Gorky is? How many of you have ever heard of Maxim Gorky? Few of you have heard of Maxim Gorky? Maxim Gorky was the great pre-Soviet playwright, wrote a play called The Lower Depths. He was the first great revolutionary intellectual of Russia who became part of the eventual Bolshevik Revolution. But he was a real serious dramatist, a playwright, and it was an idol. The kids loved him. The young people loved him when the revolution was just starting to get cooked. So she's got a picture in her wallet of Maxim Gorky, and she says, he's going to be a second Gorky. It means he's a writer. And I love him, and he's going to be second. And so Tevye says, what? Who's the first Gorky? I never heard of the first Gorky. What do I know about the second Gorky? So it's not getting any better with Tevye. Tevye is really in trouble. The audience knows it. The readers know it. Shalom Aleichem knows it. And this is simply the way the story is going to materialize. And then there's another Gentile in the story. Who? The priest. He's a priest. He's the one who's trying to help Tevye. He says, Tevye, you know, I know that we don't get along, but he's not an anti-Semite. He's not vicious. He's not nasty. He's trying to help Tevye, and Tevye can't get past the fact that the pain is great, but the shame is greater. And this is the ultimate story of shame and pain, okay? He says, this is it. I'm going to tell you the story that's now brought the pain to my whole body. And he said, I repeat, the pain is great. The disgrace is even greater. It becomes a leitmotif. What do I mean in literature by a leitmotif? It's a German phrase. Actually, it's a musical phrase for the musicologists in the class. Leit, L-E-I-T, is from the German leiten, to lead. A leitmotif, for those of you who are interested in music or opera, is what? A leitmotif, a leading motif, a theme, 16 bars, 32 parts of music that say this music is associated with a certain action or character in my opera. Who used the leitmotifs mostly? Richard Wagner. When Isolde walked on the stage, there were 16 bars of Isolde music. When Tristan walked on the stage, there's 16 bars of Tristan music. It was the leading theme as you introduced it. Dickens used the leitmotif. Also, when a character walked in on the stage and said something or did something, it was to remind you there was a character in, what was David Copperfield? Uriah Heep. Uriah Heep was a character who every time he appeared and he mentioned his name, Dickens said, and then he would rub his clammy hands together. Over and over and over, he would rub his clammy hands together. Uriah Heep was a mean, nasty, cheap, money-grubbing, miserable wretch. And Dickens didn't have to say that every time. All Dickens had to say was what? He kept rubbing his grimy little miserable hands together. He does this now with several lines. The pain is great and the disgrace is greater. So this is it. On the bottom of 81, he sees his daughter talking to this kid. He sees him talking, and there's a little dialogue there. I ask Chava, what was Fietke doing here? Nothing, she said. What do you mean nothing? We were just talking. What business have you got talking with Fietke? What business do you have talking to Fietke? What is this? This is the wall. This is the wall. You never talk to a Gentile. What business have you talking to Fietke? We've known each other for a long time, she said. Congratulations, I said. A fine friend you've picked for yourself. Do you know him at all, she asked. Do you know who he is? No, I don't. I don't know who he is. I've never seen his family tree. I'm sure he must be descended from a long and honorable line. His father must have been either a shepherd or a janitor or else just a plain drunkard. So what does Tevye do? Tevye is the Jewish equivalent of an anti-Semite. He is an anti-Goy. What does he do? What do you do? What is the basis of all prejudice? They're different, and they're all bad, and all the same. All the same. So what is it called? You got a stereotype. When you stereotype people and you find yourself stereotyping it, then that's it. And this is exactly what Tevye does. A plain drunkard. All Gentiles are drunkards. All Goyim are drunkards, right? To this, Tevye, she answers, and she gives him, there's going to be a second Gorky? Who's the first Gorky? What's going on? I don't want you talking about this. And then on next page, she's marvelous, she cried. She talks back to him. She's now talking back to her father. Unbelievable. You have a quotation for everything, she says. Maybe you also have a quotation that explains why men have divided themselves up into Jews and Gentiles, into lords and slaves, noblemen and beggars. And now, so she's got a good argument. She goes at them. She says, because that's the way God created the world, he says. That's the way God wants it. And why did God create the world this way? If we started to ask, she goes, but that is what God gave us intellect, she said, that we should ask questions. That's too much for Tevye. He can't deal with her. His kids are smarter than he is. We have an old custom, I told her, that when a hen begins to crow like a rooster, we take her away to be slaughtered. When a hen begins to crow like a rooster, when a woman or a girl starts acting and talking like a man or a boy, off to the shaykhan, off to the country. So Tevye has got all the hang-ups of the shtetl. That's it, you know? He stereotypes, and we don't want women. He's a sexist, too. That's simply, and so Sholem Aleichem is digging it all out. Okay. Then he meets the priest on page 84 in the bottom. Nice little guy, yeah, fine. I want to talk to you about yourself, that is, about your daughter. So the priest tries to warn him. At this, my heart almost turned over. What concern, we're on the bottom, could we have about my daughter? And I said to him, my daughters are not the kind, God forbid, that need someone to do the talking for them. They can manage their own affairs. But this is the sort of thing she can't speak of herself. Someone has to speak for her. It's a matter of utmost importance. Her fate is at stake. Okay. True, he said, the priest says, last line, you are our father, but you are blind to her needs. Your child is reaching out for a different world. You don't understand her, or else you don't wish to understand her. It's both. Tevye doesn't understand her, and Tevye doesn't want to understand her. He can't handle this. So Tevye doesn't want to understand her, and doesn't, then the priest says, and this is where the story gets a little dicey, because it's 1881, the bad czar, the Jews have no civil rights at all, and the priest tells her, she is now under my protection. What do you mean she's under your protection? It means that she is now in my care. He looked me straight in the eye as he said this and stroked his long flowing beard with his fingers. What? I exclaimed. My child is in your care? By what right? I felt myself losing my thought. Well, by what rights? Tevye has no rights. The shtetl, the Jew didn't have any rights when it came to a girl who decided she was going to either convert or seek asylum. That's what she's doing. She's seeking asylum, okay? And so it goes on like this. But Tevye, what is Tevye thinking about now? He says, God forbid, what's going to happen? But what's going on? And then you got to remember the shtetl environment. Turn the page to 86. I arrived at home. I arrived, and what a scene greeted me. Why? What a scene greeted me. The children all lying with their faces buried in pillows, weeping. My golda weaving around the house like a ghost. I looked for Chava. Where is Chava? What is Sholem Aleichem telling us? Bad news in the shtetl travels fast. Why? Because people pathologically love it. They love to hear bad news about somebody else. Yeah. Oh, because the communities were mixed. There were many Jews, and then servants, serfs, and poor, poor farmers, peasants, and a priest. There was a church. You could have a church, an Orthodox church, right next to the synagogue. They would be right next to each other. So you could have it in a little village with 500 people, 300 people, 800 people. You had Gentiles, you had Jews, all living together. Because Gentiles could leave where they wanted to, and they'd been living in the Pale for centuries. They didn't want to move just because the Jews were forced in. So you had all of this going on at the same time. And the Jews had the rules that they had to live by. So the news is spread around, okay? What does Tevye do? He's raging now. I let out all of my bitterness toward my wife. I let it out. I couldn't rest in the house. So I went outside to the barn to feed the horse. I found him with one leg twisted around the block of wood. It's a nice little shlemiel of a Jewish horse. He's just waiting there. One leg twisted around a block of wood. I took a stick and began laying it into him. What does he do? Out of rage, it would be interesting to see it done in the movie. You didn't see it in the movie, or you didn't see it in the Fiddler on the Roof. What's the scene that you see? You see, what's the expression on Tevye's face? If you were making this into a movie based more on the stories than on people walking around dancing with bottles on their heads, what would you see? You'd see a face contorted by rage, a face contorted by rage, doing what? Beating violently the horse. I mean, really laying into the horse, just whipping and beating and taking the skin off the horse. The horse would be neighing, the horse would be doing whatever the horse did, but Tevye does this, that's it, because now Tevye is, he doesn't know what to do next, right? She says, you know, on the top of 87, she says, how did you know Golda? She says, I told the children, run over and find her. Where is she? She's at the priest's house. He says, how did you know Golda, that she was at the priest's house? How do I know? Woe is me, Vesmir. Don't I have eyes in my head? Am I not her mother? So Golda saw that which Tevye didn't. She saw, right? If you have eyes in your head, and if you are her mother, why did you keep it to yourself? Why didn't you tell me? Tell you? When are you at home that I can tell you anything? And if I do tell you something, do you listen to me? If a person says anything to you, you answer with a quotation. You drum my head full of quotations, and you've done your duty to your children. Nice going, pop. So she gives him the final boom. And then just one little gentle twist. You've done a nice job bringing up your kids. Congratulations. Boom! And she hits him with whatever she can hit him with. You've done your duty by your children. Nice going, father. So it's not pretty. It's not pretty. It's not happy. This is it. And Golda is right in there making his life more miserable. So what does Golda say? Go to the priest and do what? Go to the priest and beg him. She says, beg on the bottom of 87. She says, beg him. She says, I hope you will go to see her and him also. If he's not a bad man, even if he is a priest, he has compassion in his heart. You'll plead with him. Get down on your knees to him. Maybe he will have pity on us. So what is she saying to him? Get down on your knees to him. Who are you talking about? I said, that priest? You want me to bow down to the priest? Are you crazy or out of your head? Do not give Satan an opening, it is said. My enemies will never live to see that day. Now, who are his enemies? My enemies will never see the day that I beg a priest. His neighbors. His enemies are just his neighbors, because what's on Tevye's mind? The pain is great, but the disgrace is greater. The disgrace is not in his children. The disgrace is going to be from his neighbors, who are not going to say, what rotten kids. They're going to say what? What's the value? What a rotten father who brought up these kids to do that. The kids are nothing. It's the parents. So Tevye is about to lose everything he can in the shtetl. My enemies will never see. What did I tell you? There he goes again, she says. You won't beg, okay? So he goes to see the priest. Tevye goes to see the priest on the top of 89, right? He says, I know, you want to bring her a piece of great good luck. I'm not speaking of that. I only want to know where my child is and if I can see her. And the priest knows he has all the arsenal in his hands, but he's also as thoughtful as he can be. Everything, yes, he said, but that, no. She's well, she's happy, and you can't see her. You can't be allowed to see her. I'm not going to let you do that, okay? That's the way we talk. I said, come to the point, no mincing of words, and now goodbye. May God repay you in equal measure for everything you have done. I came home and found Golda lying in bed, all knotted up like a black ball of yarn. She had no more tears left to weep. I said to her, get up, my wife, take off your shoes, let us sit down and mourn our child as God has commanded. Mourn her because she is to him and to the community dead. She's dead. They sit now the role of Shiva. You sit and mourn for the dead. So this kid is now officially dead. That's it. I said to her, get up. Okay. So, but Tevye's not a woman. He's not going to take any more. He's not going to cry. The family is going crazy because, again, the pain and the disgrace, but they're about to lose Chava, and it's over. They're never going to see her anymore, okay? And he says down the middle of page 90, I told everyone at home to consider Chava as dead. If you didn't get this clearly enough, there was no more Chava. Her name had been blotted out, This is a toughie. This is a tough thing to do. It happened regularly and still happens today. Any of you got anybody in the family, if you have an whether you're Jews or not, it doesn't make any difference. Anybody who married somebody that your family said is not acceptable and therefore you are gone. For the Jew, it was death. For other people, it could be just you're through. You're not now no longer a member of this family. So those situations have existed for centuries, for millennia. If you don't pick the person that your father, your mother, generally your father, wanted, this is it. So Chava is dead. There is no more Chava. Okay? Bottom of page 90, this business about Schadenfreude, which I'll write for you so you'll see it. I arrive in Boybrick, and I was met with great rejoicing. How are you, Reb Tevye? Why don't we see you anymore? How should I be? I told them. I'm the same schlamazel as always. And they began questioning me, wanting to know what kind of a cow it was that I had dropped dead, how much she had not cost. They laughed and joked and made merry. Why? Everybody already knows. And so what are they going to try to do? Stick it in. Rub it in as best you possibly can, all right? But now he's going to try to tough it out as best he can. They're all in a good mood. The weather is perfect, sunny and warm and balmy. The weather is drought. But Tevye is the sort of person who can take a joke even at his own expense. I would sooner die on the spot than let them know how I felt. So I have to maintain my yichus. I got to maintain my dignity. And that's what's going to happen now. All right? He's riding along. He's miserable. His child is dead. On the bottom of page 91, in the midst of these thoughts, I suddenly became aware that my horse had stopped. What's the matter? I lift up my eyes and look. It is she, Chava. Now, what do you think is going to happen? Chava confronts her father, not her mother, confronts her father on the road. The same as before, not changed at all. She's even wearing the same dress. My first impulse was to jump off the wagon and take her in my arms. But something held me back. What held him back? What held him back from jumping off and say, I love you. How am I going to be able to forgive a kid? How do you deal with it? Somebody, you've known this child all her life. She was a little baby in your arms, and now you're going to say she's dead? So his first instinct is, I'm going to jump off and grab her. But something held him back. What held him back? The community, tradition, whatever it is, the community values, the things we talked about when we talked about how the shtetl deals with its own values internally, the rules of the game. And the rules of the game say Chava is dead, okay? He says, stop for a while, she says. I have something to tell you. Father, I will sooner die on the spot than I'll let you move another step. I beg you, Father, listen to me. Now, what's going on? Father, stop, listen to me. What do the kids know? What does Tevye know about his relationship with his kids? Zeitel? Hodel? The girls get their way. The girls get their way. They can get their way with Zeitel. They can get their way with Hodel, but they can't get their way with Chava. He cannot forgive. He can't cross that line. Tevye can't cross that line. But she knows that if she can get him, it'll work. But Tevye's not a woman. Tevye knows how to deal with Satan, the tempter. This is Satan coming to get me, right? And he drives away. He goes past her. He drives the horse past her. He won't let her talk. And then all the rest of the way I'm driving, I said, I could hear her running after me, calling, listen, Father, listen to me. A thought crossed my mind. Tevye, you're taking too much upon yourself. Will it hurt if you stop and listen to her? Maybe I ought to stop. Maybe she had something to say that is worth hearing. Maybe, who can tell? She's regretting it, right? But he can't do it. He can't do it. And on 93, what are you fuming and fretting? I asked myself, stubborn mule, turn your wagon around, go back to her, talk to her. She is your own child. Peculiar thoughts come into my mind. What is the meaning of Jew and the non-Jew? What did God create Jews and non-Jews? So he's starting to think the way she's thinking a little bit. And then he says, I can't listen. I can't listen. It's the devil. And in order to chase away these painful thoughts, I begin to chant the words of the evening prayer. All right? She's run after him. In the middle of 93, he's praying. It'd be a great, powerful scene in Hebrew. I don't know if it ever did it in the musical. So he's praying in Hebrew. Listen, Father, listen to me. I covered my ears to stop from hearing her voice, and I shut my eyes to keep from seeing her face. Facing her face. And I started saying Shemin Esra, the prayer, and didn't know what I was saying. I beat my breast and cried out, for we have it, and I didn't know for what I was beating my breast. So it's a powerful scene again, if you made this into a movie, of her trying to yell at her father. What's he doing? He's screaming. It's almost like a scene I seen this saw the other day in Inherent the Wind, another great movie about God, religion, faith, when the daughter is trying to get her father's attention, and the father is only praying, trying to protect her. She's a sinner, and she's begging and crying and screaming. So here's Chava trying to get attention of her father, and he won't allow it to happen because he can't deal with it. All right? And he drives on and says, that's the kind of man Tevye is. And he never, ever again sees Chava. Although he dreams of it. He dreams of it. And he says at the end of the story, the last paragraph, I wonder if all men are like me, or if I'm the only crazy one. For instance, let us imagine, you suppose it should happen if I tell you this, you would laugh at me? I'm afraid that you'll laugh. But just let us suppose that one fine day, I should put on my Sabbath gabardine and stroll over to the railroad station as though I were, hold it, I lost my page, going away on the train. Going to see them. I walk up to the ticket window, ask for a ticket. The ticket seller asks me where I want to go. To Yehupetz, I tell him. And he says, there is no such place. Well, it isn't a make-believe place. It's a made-up name. And I say, well, it's not my fault then. And I turn myself around and go home again. Take off my Sabbath clothes and go home to work. All he wants to do is what? I mean, you have no idea how parents suffer. What do you know? You're only kids. Parents, there's 30 old people here. The parents know what suffering is when they can't see their children, whatever it is. Worse yet, they can't see their grandchildren. That's even worse. And so Tevye's world is falling apart. He can't believe he'll never see Chava again. I see that you're laughing at me. What did I tell you? I know what you're thinking. You're thinking that Tevye is a big imbecile. He's not talking to you. He's talking to Shalom Aleichem. That's why I said, read to this part on the great Sabbath before Passover, meaning it's enough. Don't forget what I asked you. Be silent as the grave concerning this. Don't put what I have told you into a book. And if you should write, write about someone else, but not about me. Forget about me, as it is written, and he was forgotten. No more Tevye the Dairyman, and it's over. And that was supposed to be the last of the Tevye stories. Marrying a daughter, this is it. It's over. Goodbye forever. Well, 5 years later, after a huge amount of noise, hue and cry, reader interest, begging Shalom Aleichem to bring Tevye back, he does. But 5 years have gone on, and the world has changed. I wrote to you about the Russo-Japanese War a little bit. You understand a little bit more about it. I'll fill out the details you got also. 5 years have passed, and the war has changed Russia. Russia is now on the pathway to the Bolshevik Revolution. The revolution of 1905 failed. Tevye's world, Shalom Aleichem shows up. Now, it's 1905. That means there have been 15 years of massive immigration to the United States. America shows up 4 or 5 times in the story. Shalom Aleichem shows up with how? Carrying? Shalom Aleichem shows up. Tevye says, sit down on your suitcase. Where's Shalom Aleichem going? He's leaving too. And he did come to America. He died in Brooklyn. So he came to America. So Shlomo Aleichem gets him into the story. You know, he says, sit down. He says, on the top of 96, you know, he says, move your suitcase over this way, if it would be so good, and I will sit down across from you. So Shlomo Aleichem has come with a piece of luggage, and he's on his way out to America. 1905, America is the place where they're going, both good and bad, all right? Now he tells them, you know, he says, my Golda, may she rest in peace, is dead. So Golda has died. He's got a, and he tells him, so what did Golda die of? What did Golda die of? Huh? She died of what? She died because of children moving away. Next time you think about moving away, think about Golda. So she moved, she died because she had no more children nearby to take care of. She had one purpose in life, take care of her children and to take care of maybe her grandchildren. And so she died, right? That was it. She spoke and wept bitterly. She talked to him about this. How can I live, you know, what can I live for? There's nothing I have to live for, so I'm going to die. That's the way it's going to be. And she dies. Nothing can save her. And at the end, Tevye is left alone in his house. He's got, of course, Zeitel not far away, but he's all alone in his house. And he's on the top of 97. He looks and says, oh, Lord, the things you have done to your Tevye. Who could it have been? Who else might have said that line? Oh, Lord, look, the things that you have done to your, from the Bible, the things that you've done to your, Job, the book of Job. Why me? What have I done? The things that you have done to your Tevye. What will I do now in my old age, forsaken and alone, and I threw myself on the ground? A line like that would never have ever been written in any in the shtetl. What am I going to do now alone in my old age? Why? Because when you reached old age, what were you normally? No matter how poor you were still the top dog, the patriarch, the grandparent. You were still the big one in the shtetl, okay? So now it's over, in a sense. But it's not over because he's got one daughter left to marry, and his daughter Belka has made a decision. What has Belka decided? To marry somebody who she doesn't love, but who can at least take care of her father in her old age, right? The matchmaker comes around, comes by again, talks about this guy, Padatsur, whom I've written to you a little bit about, you know, and he says, this is it. And Tevye is going to marry this, the matchmaker says it's going to be for Tevye, but it turns out to be for Belka. And Belka is going to marry the matchmaker says his name is Padatsur on the top of 100. And who is this guy? Tevye finally gets what he wants. And what is it that he always wanted? A rich guy. He also gets a character now that both Tevye and Shlomo Aleichem collectively together can dislike. And we get a character who is physically, intellectually, spiritually, utterly repulsive. And that's what Padatsur is, all right? All he wants is a good-looking woman, a good-looking young girl, right? And that's what he wants. He wants to find his daughter Belka is going to get married. The matchmaker who makes the match is already somebody we worry about, the one with seven daughters. He had another daughter who ran off to America with another guy. So people are running off to America. The people who are staying behind have to have a reason why America is not so attractive. And so this one now, now comes this rich man, Padatsur. Who is Padatsur? What is he? Where does he make his money? How does he make his money? Again, if this story were written in any other language, you'd say it's written by an anti-Semite. Because what is Padatsur? He's a contractor, but where? How does he make his money? Where is he making his money? What country does he have his biggest connections? Japan. And how did he make his money? And when did he make his money? And what would you call him today? Whether it's Halliburton or whatever, what was he? Potemkin Plumbing and Bathroom Supplies in Goodbye Columbus? Put in every set of toilets in Fort Dix, New Jersey? These are people who made their money during a war. They are called, what's the negative term? Just like we call people who got rich in the 19th century robber barons, what do we call people who got rich in a war? War profiteers, war profiteers, people who profited from war. Podazor is a war profiteer, right? Tevye at first doesn't think that, you know, that she should, that she doesn't understand why his daughter married this guy. But on the bottom of 101, you know, he says, my other daughters wouldn't have done this. Jewish people in the shtetl had a way of comparing their children constantly. This one is this, this daughter is gold, this one is silver, this one is platinum, this one is iron, this one is nothing. You compare your children constantly. Your brother's doing better. Whatever it was, you couldn't be a winner. And the bottom of 101, Tevye says, you know, Huddle wouldn't have treated me like this. And finally, Belka blurts out, don't compare me to Huddle. Huddle grew up in a time when the whole world rocked on its foundations. Namely, when? What was in the air? The whole world rocked on its foundations. Revolution was in the air. When it was ready at any moment to turn upside down. In those days, people were concerned about the world and forgot about themselves. Now that the world is back to where it was, people think about themselves and forget about the world. Now the world is, you know, people talk about the millennials, they talk about this generation, that generation, the selfish generation, whatever. What is Belka saying? Huddle was an, what was Huddle? An idealist? What am I? A realist. I'm a realist, and she says, she doesn't say, I had to find a way to take care of my father, and I'm going to do it, and she did it. So I married this guy who we both despise, okay? They had a wedding, very fancy. They went off to a place called Nitali, because Tevye never heard of Italy, and they come back, and then we see the complete reversal. What does the son do? They're living in a big city. He has special dispensation from the Tsar. Podazor lives in the big city, and what does he do? He calls to Tevye and says, what? Come see me. So it's the son-in-law now ordering the father to come visit. Tevye decides he's got to. He's got nobody else to deal with it. All right? He dreams. He wonders what this guy's going to be like. On the bottom of 103, tell Madame Podazor that she has a visitor. Her father, Tevye, has come to see her. Has been standing outside for comes quite time like a beggar at the door. Let me in. So he goes in. Tevye looks around when he goes into the house in Yehupa. What does he see? What does Tevye always still measure things by? Things. He sees big chairs. He sees tables. Mirrors everywhere. He loves it. He likes the idea that there's big time money. So he got what he really wants. And then comes in comes Podazor, whom he had seen before. What's the leitmotif of Podazor? The leitmotif. Not Uriah Heep with the hands, but what is it? There's something. What is it that he? What does he constantly do? What has he got? 5, 6, 7 times. It's called what? In the English translation, a sniggering laugh. A sniggering laugh. Whatever it is, it's obnoxious and you hate it. He's got a bald head. He's a short guy. He's glistening. He sweats. I mean, the physical character. What is he? He is repulsive. He's a repulsive guy, and he talks like a repulsive, obnoxious guy, right? Tevye, all of a sudden, having gotten what he wants, he's upset about it. The sniggering laugh he can't stand anymore. Tevye is just miserable at this guy. They sit down finally, and on the top of 107, he says to his father-in-law, do you know why I have sent for you? I have sent for you, okay? And then in the middle of 107, he laughed that irritating laugh of his. What do you think of a man like that? He seems to me that if God had chastised you by making you illiterate, at least keep it under your hat. But Tevye doesn't like him. He says, further, I want to tell you, it isn't fitting, considering the scale of my enterprises, that you should, that and the repute in which my name is held, as well as the station in life, that you should be known as Tevye the Dairyman. I'll have you know that I am personally acquainted with the governor and that he's very, this guy's a windbag. And loves to pump himself up, right? In finishing speaking, I sat there and looked at his shiny, bald spot and thought to myself, well, you talk like a common cur. But that doesn't stop Podazor. I would like you to give up the dairy business, he says on 108. Go into something else. Maybe you should also, besides that, I would feel better if I could get rid of you altogether. Get rid of you, send you out. Now, we only have one more minute to get through this. I'm not going to get through it, but I'll send you the stuff anyway. We're through with Tevye after we get through here. Tevye's going to go off to Palestine. Everybody else is going to America by this time, but Tevye's going to go to Palestine. You have two more stories to read for Thursday. On Thursday, we'll go over the two non-Tevye stories, also go over the exam. So we'll have a big full day on Thursday. The exam is already online. If you want to take a look at it, try to copy it and bring it a copy with you on Thursday. Yeah.